this time I'd like to introduce my wife and my soulmate, who will bring us the message. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child.
Glasses adjusted too, we might be all set here. Okay, well, good morning. I'm Joe Shaffer, and I wanted to start with something that we did yesterday at our retreat because I thought it was kind of fun and nothing else will wake you up. Before I do that, I want to thank Kathy in particular because the retreat was incredible. It was a great experience. I'm sure everyone that was there got a tremendous amount from it, and I just really appreciate all the time and effort it takes to do something like this. Thank you, Kathy, and thanks to everybody who came. So our little exercise went like this, and those of you who were there, please help us out. Everyone was asked to respond to three questions. How do you feel physically this morning? How do you feel spiritually? And what do you want to get from today's experience? My answers this morning are in order. Physically, I'm still vertical. Spiritually, I'm still hopeful. And I'll tell you my answer to the third question in just a minute. But now it's your turn, and what I want you to do is all together simultaneously, because we don't have time to go around the room. And in just one word, tell me, how do you feel physically this morning?
Great.
Okay. Terrific. And how do you feel spiritually?
Oh,
yes, really good, really good. Okay, and what do you hope to gain from today's experience?
Peace.
All of those things. Yes, yes. Very, very good. Well, what I would like to gain is the opportunity to share with you a little bit of information about homelessness and also share with you my concern, my passion, and in fact, bordering on outrage for how we as citizens have dealt with this problem nationally and locally. So, back to the questions. How do you suppose a motherless child might feel? Why is that the description that's used in the old African-American spiritual that we just sang? What are the images in your mind's eye? Maybe some of you can even describe your own experience with that type of feeling. What I suppose is that a motherless child feels lost, maybe abandoned, alone, hungry, confused, doesn't know which way to turn, and doesn't know who, if anyone at all, might help them and not hurt them. This is a frightening and a sad way to live, and yet we allow it continuously for an increasingly large segment of our population. Those without shelter, those who are vulnerable and suffering, still belong to this community. They are ours because, like you and me, they live here. They may not have a roof over their heads. They may be sleeping in a car parked next to Lake Caroline, or maybe under the Hathaway Bridge, on the beach, in the woods, or in a doorway on Harrison Avenue. But they are part of our environment, part of our community, and their presence clearly demonstrates how we have all chosen to live in a bifurcated society that not only allows, but often enables this state of existence. Beyond the physical hardship and emotional anguish for those who are homeless, homelessness also has a cost to the community, to you and to me. Even if we are not concerned with the human cost and the human suffering, there is significant financial cost to us to allow homelessness to continue, especially in the numbers we now see. Today I want to look at the issues of homelessness and poverty solutions. I want to investigate what homelessness is and is not, what it costs, and how it came to be this way, what we are prepared individually and collectively as a fellowship and as a community to do about it. First, some statistics, and I went heavy on the statistics because I know how much Al loves them. And since he invited me to speak, I want to make sure he gets his fill. Probably before I'm done, I'll be going, Way too much information. But these statistics really show the nature of our problem. They dramatically illustrate how significant this problem is. So to begin, there are 16 million children living in poverty in the United States. Almost 1,500 homeless children right now in Bay County. That's a staggering statistic. The number has risen about 200 just since last school year. 59% of all the school children in Bay District schools are participating in the free lunch program. Unfortunately, 3 million or more people each year become homeless. This has been true for the past decade. Only 10% approximately of the total number of homeless persons are the chronically homeless, or those who choose to be homeless as a lifestyle. In today's world, 90% of homelessness is due to unemployment or gross underemployment, meaning income that does not cover basic needs, or disabilities caused by lack of physical health care or mental health issues. In fact, a study done in Alachua County, Florida, indicates that 22% of their homeless population were actually born in Alachua County and have spent their whole lives there. And another 40% have been there for 10 years or more. So those are definitely not transients. Nationwide, depending on the geographic area, one in every four or five homeless men are veterans. Here, it's almost 40% in this community, or more than one in three. And I'm told that with the number of veterans coming home from Iraq and Afghanistan, that number could soon be one in every two. Homeless men are veterans. Do you know that one-fourth of the nation's homeless live right here in your state of Florida? Do you know that two-thirds of those families in Florida live on the street as opposed to a friend's apartment or something like that? In fact, the longevity of homelessness continues to rise as persons exhaust their own resources and then the resources of their friends, their neighbors, their extended family. The result is homelessness. Friends and neighbors and family are also suffering the consequences of the poor economy and can do little as individuals to provide any meaningful assistance. It used to be that families would take care of family members in need, but fewer and fewer families are able to do that. For an example of the depth of our problem in a national comparison, let me compare Bay County to the county where I lived in Colorado. Jefferson County, Colorado has a population of more than 500,000 persons as part of metropolitan Denver. And it has a homeless population, men, women, and children, of just over 1,000. But Bay County has a population of 168,852 people and 1,500 homeless children. So Jefferson County, more than three times the size of Bay County by population, and an urban county as well, has 1,000 men, women, and children in total that do not account for as many persons as just our homeless children here in Bay. So you're getting an idea of the size of our problem. In fact, many of you may recall, as it was heavily publicized in our local media, that Dr. Robert Marbot, who's a national expert on homelessness, visited here in January of this year. And he said that here in Bay County, we have the single greatest homeless problem of any community in America for the size of our population. Absolutely staggering and sobering. Here's something else that's really sobering. In the state of Florida, we spend $40 per person on mental health services. In Alabama, the next closest state geographically and also in terms of a dollar comparison, the number is $80 per person, twice as much. And in Mississippi, it's $120 per person. Stated differently, Florida is 50th out of 50 states in the country for expenditures on mental health programs. Absolute blast. So quickly you come to understand that we have a very large homeless population in Florida and very few resources with which to deal with the situation. And the situation doesn't improve when you turn to the federal government for help. Federal spending for social service programs peaked in the mid-70s, shortly after the war on poverty was initiated. It has been decreasing ever since, and it is now approximately 10% of what it was in the 1970s. When you adjust for today's dollars and population. So, while homelessness may be a national problem, we have to find a local solution. In fact, the only thing that's going to address this issue is a local initiative. From a practical standpoint, in order to deal with our situation, we must, as a community, change our perspective and recognize that managing the symptoms of poverty, even if we did that well, would not effectuate the results for which we are looking. In much the same way that we all have learned that treating or medicating the symptoms of disease does not cure it, we must understand that we must address the root causes of poverty and homelessness if we are going to have any systemic and permanent effect. So while the causes of homelessness are complex, the reoccurring themes that emerge are poverty, the lack of affordable housing, and the need for services. But here, our system is fragmented. The services that we have difficult accessing. Homeless people don't have transportation and other resources to be able to get around and know where the services are and be able to go and take advantage of what is available. So, what will we do about it? Well, about 2.5 years ago now, an idea to raise public awareness was suggested by a local homeless advocate. And thanks to the sponsorship of Gulf Coast State College, the idea became a reality. A series of public forums were held, and a wide variety of persons participated. Clearly a small but significant number of these area residents had become concerned. From these meetings came a list of issues and ideas. Now, usually, this is where projects like this come to a halt. A report is written, placed in a notebook, labeled, and then shelved. Probably never to be seen or heard from again. In fact, 5 years earlier, a local expert tried a demonstration project, compiled a notebook, and when no one was interested enough to take any action or provide any funding, she gave it up and went back to her private practice. But this time, two extraordinary things happened simultaneously. A few big thinkers, and I didn't name the group that, but you know, it's kind of catchy. Go big or go home. these big thinkers couldn't let this go again and allow such a big problem to continue to be ignored. So a small group of 4 or 5 persons kept quietly meeting, hoping, planning. During the same period, the mayoral race was going on in Panama City. The homeless issue from the public forums had become a public presence and now a political issue. Our current mayor, Brunicki, made dealing with the homeless issue a cornerstone of his campaign. When he won the race, he actually decided to pursue it. Yes. Mayor B appointed a homelessness task force to figure out what to do. The situation had progressed to the point that homelessness had become a public issue, but figuring out how to handle it was a whole different matter. Happily, when the mayor appointed his task force, the big thinkers were included. And meanwhile, they'd figured out some things. How to request and receive a planning grant, how to connect with service providers, large and small, within the county and throughout the state. So what did we propose? Well, we proposed a community resource center campus model with a continuum of housing services from emergency shelter to transitional housing to respite care to permanent supportive housing and community placement, along with a comprehensive support services system and a centralized case management system. And then an amazing thing occurred. You must understand that in the city of Panama City, they have never directly administered any social service program. A county does not administer or fund social service programs. It is the philosophy of both governments, both local governments, and those of our surrounding municipalities that bricks and mortar are their purview. They build roads and bridges. They don't want to take responsibility for social service programs. However, after facilitating work of the planning committee of the mayor's task force and designing the mission, the organization of a service delivery system and a 10-year plan, and completing a comprehensive proposal, sitting over there in that chair, to proceed, this project is actually underway. The planning committee is in the process of negotiating with 18 local service providers to provide comprehensive services at the new community resource center on our community campus. In fact, let me tell you who those folks are, because you'll recognize a lot of them, and I think you'll be pleased. The Anchorage Children's Home, the Department of Children and Families, the Salvation Army, Catholic Charities, the Transitional Recovery Mission, Early Learning Coalition, Early Education and Care, BASIC, Life Management Center, CARE, Goodwill Industries, the Workforce Board, the Council on Aging, the Family Service Agency, the Panama City Housing Authority, the Springfield Housing Authority, and Panama City Rescue Mission. And we've also arranged to have Volunteers of America Florida build a transitional housing complex on this site. Yes, the funding they will be receiving from a grant they wrote. Yes, and I'll be in Tampa all next week negotiating that funding. So our plans call for a resource center where we'll have meeting rooms, training rooms, facilities for all these providers to be housed, and for folks doing the intake, the triage, the case management, all together in one location. We'll also have a healthcare clinic on site and these housing complexes, and eventually probably a lot more things. I know that now the county has taken a listen and decided maybe this would be a fine place to build a new probation department. So it is my great pleasure to announce to you, and you are the first people hearing this, there are only three people in this town that know, and it's a secret, so don't tell me. Oops. Because really, Mayor Bernicke gets to announce these things in a public way, but I thought I'd just give you a little heads up this morning. We now have a contract to purchase 70 acres of land for this community campus. So, what are the problems? What are the potential problems with our grand solution? Well, there are many. The one that you all might be most interested in right now is the current status of the rescue mission. Will it willingly move to the new site? Will it cooperate? Who should determine what programs it will continue to run? What if it still insists on its Christian focus? And what if it continues to require a Christian service before each meal that it offers? That's a real dilemma. It's a real dilemma for all of us. It is the group that's been providing the service that we have, the emergency shelter, and it has gotten people off the street on an emergency basis. However, clearly it has not been nearly capable of dealing with the huge problems that we have. It doesn't have the capacity. The building is old, and that they're in is old and has lots of fire code violations and scary things like that. And it doesn't offer any support services or any central system of coordination and data management. So we will have to address, we'll have to figure out how to work through lots of issues that are still on the horizon. But why is this a great thing to do? And I'm going to hurry through this part a little bit because I know we're running out of time now. But I do want to tell you why this is such a great thing to do. It's because it provides an economy of scale. Everything will be co-located, coordinated, with no gaps in service, but rather we'll have a continuum of services. And we'll have a centralized coordination system so that hopefully we can address needs as they come up and not send people all around town shopping at scattered sites. The campus concept provides for a secure environment, and not only does it you know, keep homeless folks largely in one area and away from area residents who are concerned. It protects the program participants from the area residents so that they can concentrate on getting the services that they need and stay in a comfortable space while they're doing that. It's going to be supported by transportation systems, and there'll be a lot of room. With 70 acres, you can do a lot of things. You can have community gardens, you can have vocational training sites, you can have cottage industry development, you can do a lot of things, and we hope someday to do most of them. And for the participants, the program participants, well, they get their needs met. They're going to be in a transformational program with rapid reentry and housing combined with vocational training, whatever educational support they may need. And for many people, it'll be a chance to visit the doctor to get prescription medicine, which will make all the difference in their stability. They'll have a holistic plan and a follow-on program that will help them immediately and for the next 5 years as they transition back into the community. What do the providers get out of it? Well, they get a collaborative environment, they get a support system, and they will have one volunteer program, a client mentoring program, staff training and benefits, grant writing and funding strategies, and public information, as well as shared space, utilities, security, and other costs, that are covered and not a distraction. So rather than having to do everything themselves, which is very difficult for a small nonprofit, they will save dollars and the time that it takes, and they can put that into their program and service delivery. What does the city get? Well, it gets the homeless folks off the street, and it also clears the way for the development of our new city marina, for the federal courthouse, and for all those things that will make Panama City residents perhaps happier, but it will be a healthier and I hope happier place to be. There'll be less cost to all of us because our police department will save significantly. They won't be responsible for homeless services. They won't have to pick them up and take them to jail, which by the way costs roughly $100, $120 per trip, while a visit to the Community Resource Center and staying there costs $20. So that's a significant cost advantage. Back to Dr. Robert Marbot, he suggests that we're going to save about $500,000 each year in emergency room costs, and even more when you tally the ambulance costs of getting folks to the emergency room. They'll have a health care clinic and they can be treated on site. So, in closing, I would simply state that this is a work in progress. It is just now moving from the conceptual stage to the implementation stage. You all have the opportunity to know it and support it from its very beginning. You have the opportunity to be ambassadors for this project and tell people about it, and I hope say great things everywhere you go. It's a very important project, and one that you can really be proud of. So I would ask that, as we did in the retreat yesterday, I place my hand in yours, pledge to work together with you to do that which I cannot do alone. In closing, keep alert, stand firm in your faith, be courageous, be strong, and let all that you do be done in love. 1 Corinthians 13.